Hey dear students, today we are going to discuss about DC generator. Okay, what DC generator do? It converts mechanical energy into electrical energy. It works on the principle of Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. And what Faraday's law says, when a conductor cuts the magnetic field, an EMF induced in that conductor, and that is in that induced EMF is given by E equals to minus N dP by dt, where N is the number of conductors, those are cutting the magnetic field, and dP by dt gives the rate of change of flux with respect to time. Okay. It follows the Fleming's right hand rule to determine the direction of flow of current. Okay, or polarity of induced EMF means through Fleming's right hand rule we can determine the direction of flow of current, or we can determine the polarity of induced EMF. Here look at this expression. Here minus sign indicates the Faraday's law following the Lenz rule. When we talk about the construction of DC generator, that means what we are requiring? We are requiring the magnetic field and a conductor which is cutting that magnetic field. So on that basis, we are going to describe the construction of a DC generator. Okay? ओके, दिस इज अ जनरल रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ ए डीसी जनरेटर. ऑन दैट बेसिस वी कैन डिस्क्राइब इट्स वेरियस पार्ट्स. लाइक फर्स्ट वन इज योक, अनदर इज आर्मेचर, okay. Now we explain the various components of DC generator one by one. First discuss with the start with the yoke. You know this part is known as external part or covering part is known as yoke of any DC generator. It keeps the, there are two functions of this part. One, these are the two utility or two works of yoke. First one, it holds the field poles as seen in the diagram, as well as it provides the path for magnetic flux so that magnetic lines can flow through north pole to south pole. Okay, as well as it provides, you know, mechanical support, or you know, it provides a covering to a DC generator form. So that its winding should not affect by the environment. As well as it is carrying the terminal box. Here we can say this is our terminal box. Okay. So this is the utility of yoke here. Now we talk about the armature. Armature is a rotating part. Armature is a rotating part, which is for small machines, for small generators. It is made of cast iron, and for large machine it is made of rolled steel. So first construction point of view, it is made of cast iron for small DC generators, and for large generators it is made of rolled steel or cast steel. What is function? Its function is to provide space or place for the armature conductors, where we can place the armature winding, or we can say it is having number of slots, and on those slots we put armature winding. And when we put the armature winding in these slots, and with the help of prime mover, when this armature rotates, it cuts the magnetic fields. So we get the induced EMF. So it is a very important part of the DC generator, because it carries the armature winding, and since it is rotating with the help of prime mover, these armature windings are cutting the magnetic flux. That's why we are getting the induced EMF. Okay. Now we talk about the armature winding or armature conductor. Generally we are using armature conductor made of copper. Okay, there are two kind of windings are there. One is lap and another is wave type of winding, which we are going to describe in a later stage. Now there are, you know, there are single layer as well as double layer windings. We can say again single layer सिंगल एयर मीन्स इफ ईच स्लॉट इज कैरिंग ओनली वन कंडक्टर वाइंडिंग देन इट इज नॉन एज सिंगल एयर वाइंडिंग एंड इफ एनी स्लॉट ऑफ आर्मेचर इज हैविंग टू वाइंडिंग्स इन ए वन स्लॉट देन इट इज कॉल्ड ए डबल एयर वाइंडिंग ओके नाउ फ्यूल पोल्स एंड पोल शूज सो दिस इज अ डायग्रामेटिक रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ फ्यूल पोल्स दोज आर प्रोवाइडिंग अस मैग्नेटिक फील्ड एंड दिस पार्ट इज पोल शूज सो व्हाट इज द फंक्शन ऑफ फ्यूल पोल्स फ्यूल पोल्स आर द इलेक्ट्रिक पोल्स व्हेन कंडक्टर करंट फ्लोज थ्रू द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड वाइंडिंग इट क्रिएट्स मैग्नेटिक फ्लक्स एंड विच पासेस फ्रॉम नॉर्थ पोल टू साउथ पोल एंड एज पर द डायरेक्शन ऑफ करंट फ्लोइंग थ्रू दीज मैग्नेटिक फील्ड पोल्स द नॉर्थ पोल एंड साउथ पोल डिसाइड्स एंड दैट इज बेस्ड ऑन द थंब रूल By thumb rule or corkscrew rule, north pole or south poles are decided or we can say manufactured. So, what is the utility of field poles? In the field poles, we are having field conductors, and when a conductor flows through field conductors, on the basis of thumb rule or corkscrew rule, it acts as north pole or it acts as south pole. Okay? And what is the utility of pole shoes? So, look at this diagram. These pole shoes are having two functions. First one, it holds the magnetic field winding, and another, it provides uniform air gap. What are the utilities? Holds the field winding. Another is provides. Uniform air gap. Okay, these are the two utilities of pole shoes. Now we talk about the commutator. Okay, so in general practice, when we go for the generation of electrical power, we always get the AC generation. But with the help of slip rings. Sorry, with the help of if we are using the slip rings, then we will get the AC power. And instead of slip rings, or if the slip rings are replaced by split rings, we will get the DC output. That means uniform magnitudes output we will get. So here we are discussing the commutator. So commutator is a what we can say it is a rotating switch which rotates itself. When the direction of current is changing, else what will happen when the current of direction is changing the armature conductor, definitely the direction of current flowing through the external load will change. But what we are requiring that in the case of DC, the current direction should not change. So for that purpose, we are using the commutator. It is used for two purposes. First is it collects the current from armature winding, that's the proper word, and rotating switch. It is a rotating switch, okay, which converts AC into DC. How? When direction of current changes, it changes its position. Okay? How converts AC into DC? When direction of current changes in the armature winding, at the same time it changes its position. So in the outer circuit, the current direction does not change. Okay? Now, what is the now another term is brushes. Brushes it collects the current from commutator and sends it to the load end. Okay, generally we go for the carbon brushes or graphite. Another one is bearings. Bearings are used to support the shaft of generator and second, it reduces the friction. Okay, so this is a construction detail of DC generator. Okay, now another is armature winding. There are two types of winding, one is lap, another is wave winding. Okay, first discuss, it is used for where large current is required. It is used where okay. So there are two types of winding, one is lap winding, another is wave winding. Where these are used, we are using these windings. Lap winding is used where we want large amount of current, and wave winding is used where we want a large voltage. So we go for the wave winding. Okay, now construction point of view, how it is seems. So So this is a representation of lab winding, in which this is the front part and this is the back part. Here look at, it is forming a lab, as we see in the racing structures or racing sites, where it is forming a lab and in this kind of winding we can say when the back of any coil which is connected to the front of another coil, that kind of winding is known as lab winding, and it is seen in the this kind of diagram. Here for lab winding, number of A equals to P, that is number of poles. Okay? And in the case of wave winding, as its name indicates, wave is forming. From the construction point of view, as its name indicates, it will like a wave is forming here. Now, so this is a construction representation of wave kind of winding. Now we can see that it is moving as how wave moves, that's why it is called as wave winding. Here number of parallel path A equals to always 2, that is fixed for wave winding. For the derivation of EMF equation of a DC generator, that means how much EMF will be generated in a DC generator, how we can determine with the formula. And we have to derive that particular expression. So for that purpose we are assuming pi is the flux per pole in Weber, number of armature conductor rotation number of poles equals to n divided by dt. Okay. For one conductor n equals to 1, so e equals to d divided by dt. there are p number of poles and each pole is having flux phi. Therefore, the total flux will be p into phi. So here p into phi is the total amount of flux that is going to change with respect to time. So it is given by d phi equals to p into phi. And revolution per second is n by 60. Therefore, with respect to time, dt equals to 60 by n. Okay. After putting these values in this expression, we will obtain e equals to p phi n upon 60 for one conductor. EMF induced in one conductor is given by p phi n upon 60. Okay, for one conductor. If for Z conductors E equals to I Z N P E phi N into Z upon 60. For Z conductor means total number of conductors are Z and all conductors will be placed in a particular parallel path. So we have to tell the armature conductors per parallel path, that is given by Z by A. Therefore E equals to P phi N upon 60 into Z by A. So it can be combined in E equals to phi Z N P upon 68. This is the expression of EMF generation. For left winding, A equals to P. For wave winding, A equals to 2 always. Okay. So I am explaining one unit again. These are terms we are going to use here. Since E equals to N5 by VT, and if we are taking only one conductor, then N equals to 1. Now, definitely since there are P number of poles, and or we can say it is pole pair, that will be better presentation. And each pole pair is having phi flux. The total number of flux in the machine will be P into phi. Therefore, the rate of change of flux is given by how much amount of flux will be changed? That is given by P into phi. That means that much amount of flux will be changed due to the rotation of armature conductor. And now we talk about revolution per second. That is given by N by 60. dt equals to 60 upon N. And since we are having this expression, E equals to d phi by dt, putting these values for one conductor. And if you are talking about the armature conductors per parallel path, that is equal to Z upon A. Then in this expression we are putting this value because we are having lot number of many number of conductors, and these conductors are placed in parallel path also. That's why we are taking Z by A. So this expression is given by E equals to 5 MP upon 68. And for left winding parallel path is A equals to P. And for wave winding, A equals to 2. that was all about, you know, that was about the decision maker. In the previous section, we discussed about the overhead lines or power transmission through overhead lines. Now we are taking another part, that is underground cables. So what is the difference between the overhead line and underground cable? The only one difference, that is the, in the case of overhead lines, we were taking the maximum voltage Vm between the conductor and ground, but in the case of underground cables, the Vm will be the maximum voltage that is taken between two conductors only. As all the parameters means the P is the power we want to transmit, the L is the small L is the length of transmission line, and W is the losses, all the factors are common for both cases. Only what thing is changing? The maximum voltage. In the previous section, in the overhead lines, we are taking maximum voltage Vm between the conductor and the, now we are taking the Vm maximum voltage between the two conductors in the case of underground power transmission or in the underground cables. So what will be the change? I am mentioning directly. For single phase two wire AC system with one conductor earth, thank you. Okay. So these are the various kind of systems used for power transmission, and this is the volume of conduct required for underground power transmission. I am mentioning that because we are doing the procedure. The procedure same as the overhead lines. So through that procedure, we will determine the volume of conductor required in the underground cable. And now we can compare the underground cables power transmission with the overhead power transmission. Okay, that's all.